Anybody glad for the everlasting arms tonight? Anybody glad to be saved tonight? Are you? Are you sure? Amen. Do you love the Lord tonight? Are you sure? Tabitha, are you sure? All right. Have you got all your kids? Did you count heads? Oh, you can't leave your kids here right now. All right. And the Lord good? Anybody enjoy this day today? Anybody enjoy the sunshine? Y'all gonna make it hard on me now, didn't you? Have you enjoyed anything about today? Amen. Praise God. Amen. I haven't got a word out of just Gary. I ain't got a word out of you three women here. What did y'all say? Y'all said amen? Did they? Must have been to themselves what I thought. Man. He can't hear. Amen. I tell you what, let's do. Let's give the Lord a good hand clap of praise God. Praise God. Amen. It's an awesome God tonight. Hallelujah. Anybody consider him to be awesome in your life tonight? Amen. Has anybody been blessed since Sunday, since the last time we was in the building Sunday? Amen. Is he not a faithful God? God is faithful. Amen. Faithful to his word, faithful to his name tonight. Let me go with a prayer request right real quick, and we'll go to the Lord in prayer tonight. We got one unspoken request on the prayer list. We got Marta Mitchell on here tonight. Also Jordan Mitchell. Sister Linda Counts on the prayer list tonight. Just remember her as you pray. We got Amanda Fisher. We got the Lester family on here. We got Stephen. Also, Christine has to go back to the doctor. I believe we're back to Duke. Right, where'd she go? Back there, she is. So let's remember her as we pray. Also, we got Eva Witt with breathing problems tonight. And LaWanna's on the prayer list. Very sick tonight, so let's remember her tonight. Okay, anybody else got a spoken request tonight before we go to the Lord in prayer? Anybody? Anybody got a Anybody? All right. Anybody got an unspoken question? I'll lift a hand tonight. Anybody got anybody lost in your family tonight? That's all I need to know. Come on, let's pray. Come on. Let's gather around here tonight. Let's call on the name of the Lord tonight. Amen. If you got somebody lost tonight, you got something to pray about tonight. Amen. You know somebody that needs a touch of God, you got something to pray about tonight. Amen. You know anybody hurting tonight, you got something you need to pray about tonight. So come on, let's gather in here tonight. Let's lift our voice to the living God tonight. Father, we want to thank you again this evening for your love, your mercy, your goodness. Again, Father, for the privilege that we have to be able to gather tonight in the house of the living God, to be able to gather tonight in the name of the Lord Jesus, and to be able to exalt the name of the Lord. And one more privilege and opportunity we have just to be able to come to this house tonight and lift our voice in praise unto the living God. Again, we have the privilege to come together with people like Precious Faith. Again, we have the privilege to come tonight and to come together to exalt the name of the Lord Jesus tonight and to call upon a God that I know that is able to do the exceeding, the abundant, the above all that we can ask or think tonight. And I'm just so thankful that we serve a God tonight that I know that his ear is not too dull that he cannot hear, or his arm too short that he cannot say. I'm thankful tonight that you can still reach and you can still touch man. I'm thankful tonight that you can still bring conviction upon those, God, that need salvation. And every home represented in this room tonight with somebody unsaved in it, we do plead the blood over their soul tonight. Every son and daughter tonight that's represented to these moms and dads, we pray for them. Every unsaved husband, every unsaved member of these families tonight, we bring before the throne of God, knowing that it is your will that none perish but all would come to repentance tonight. And I'm just so thankful and grateful tonight that we can call upon a God that I know that is able to reach their very soul. I'm so thankful tonight to know that it is your will and it is your desire that they be saved. And Lord, to know that the word tells us that they are of our household and believing tonight that salvation is going to come. And to those, God, we lift to you here this evening, to those we bring before the throne of God. Every physical infirmity tonight on that prayer list we bring before the throne, knowing that you're a God that is not intimidated by any disease tonight, knowing that you've been given a name above every name, and knowing tonight that if we can put a name on it, you've been given a name above that name. You're not intimidated by cancer or by tumors or any blood disorders or lupus or any disease known to man tonight, but you're a God that I know that provided our physical healing. You're a God tonight that I know that provided our emotional healing, our relational healing, healings, Lord. Every healing that we need tonight, we know has already been provided, and so we speak healing over those bodies tonight. Lord, we just speak peace over the minds tonight that are being tormented by the enemy, knowing tonight that it is your will that our emotional state be healed, knowing tonight that the enemy will play havoc on our mind, but knowing tonight that greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. And tonight, God, we're just speaking peace over the minds tonight that may be troubled, knowing that you're the answer to their need. Knowing tonight that you're the God that is able, and you're the God that I know that has the answer to every threat of the enemy. I know tonight that there's no valley too deep that you cannot reach in and grab a hold of your people. I know there's no darkness too dark that the light of God cannot shine in. I know there's hope tonight in the midst of hopelessness. And I'm so thankful tonight that you're a God that has granted us and given us the hope of all glory, and that is Christ in us tonight. Holy Ghost, we need you this meeting tonight. It's just not another place thing that we do during the week, but Lord, we come here tonight on purpose. We come here for a reason tonight. We come here not only to worship you, but we have come here to hear the word of the living God. We come here tonight to hear what the word is saying to the church, and we're praying that you will open our ears up, open our hearts up, that we can receive the engrafted word of God that is able to save our soul. Help us, I pray tonight, that we can hear with a spiritual ear, our hearts can be opened up to the word of God, and we can receive what you need for us to receive in this room tonight. Father, our nation, we bring before the throne of God, praying for the leaders and our president tonight, that God, you would some way begin to intervene in this nation and raise up men and women of God that can turn this nation around. I pray tonight for every leader, all of our congressmen and all of our senators, God, those that are gathering, that are making decisions that affect this nation. We pray that God, that you in some way begin to intervene. Holy Ghost, we ask you to get behind those closed door sessions and begin to sway men's opinions tonight. Lord, I pray for our military tonight. We pray for our men and women that wherever they are across this world of unrest, we pray and bring before the throne of God, asking you tonight that you would give our military the intelligence they need to locate their enemy. Asking you tonight that God would rise and his enemies would be scattered. Lord, we bring this nation before you, that you'll just begin to move within this nation. And help us as a nation, God, that we would be, that we would repent, oh God, for our waywardness and for the direction that our nation is going. We need a national day of repentance, and I'm praying that you would raise up men and women, leaders of this nation, to call a national day of repentance, that the church and this nation can return back to the things that we were founded on. God, we need you this hour, we do. If we've ever needed a move of God, if we've ever needed a restoration, we need it in this hour. If we've ever had men and women in leadership in this nation that can hear from God, we need it in this hour. So we ask you to move within this nation and do in this nation what only you can do. We love you tonight, we do. We ask you to continue overshadowing this meeting and do in this house what needs to be done. And we'll give you praise and glory, for we ask it in Jesus' mighty name tonight. Amen. Hallelujah.
Jesus.
Yes. Yes.
For I find
my. Sing it, that girl. Sing it. Yes. Yes.
For I find
my. Come on, church. Let's worship him tonight. Come on, let's worship him tonight. Get on your feet. Let's worship him tonight. Come on. Could be the last time you'll ever have the opportunity to worship him. Come on, sing out of your heart, baby, tonight. We need that peace tonight. Yes, we do. We welcome that peace tonight. Come, Holy Ghost, come. We need you. We need you. We don't need another sermon. We need you. Come, will you meet with us tonight in this room? We need your Holy Ghost to come and heal the hurts of your people. Help us, I pray, to reconcile the tremendous need of our life tonight. That is you tonight. That is you. Oh, God.
More I seek you.
My. Come on, Andrew. Sing that thing. Sing. Yes. Wow.
More I find
my. Oh, God, we need you. We need you. We need you.
More I find you.
My.
Jesus.
Yes. Oh, blessed be God. Well, blessed be God. Yes, Lord. Yes.
I want to see that holy drink from the cup in your hand.
Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. How we desire your presence, Lord. How we desire your presence in this house tonight, God. Hallelujah, how we desire just to meet with you tonight, God. Hallelujah. Jesus, Jesus, we desire you tonight, Lord. We desire you tonight, God.
All of creation, all of the earth, make straight a highway, a path for the Lord. Jesus is coming soon. Call every sinner, wake up the saint, let every nation shout your fame. Jesus is coming soon. Like a bride waiting for her groom, you'll be a church ready for you. Every heart longing for our King, we sing, even so come.
We wait, your
begin to tell him how much you love him and how much you long for him tonight. Father God, we long for you, Lord. We long just to be in your presence, God. We long, God, just for moments with you, Lord. Moments with you, God, for in your presence, God, there is peace, Lord. And in your presence, there is joy, God. Hallelujah. In your presence, there is fullness, there is wholeness, there is perfection, God. In your presence, Father God, is everything that we need. In your presence is provision, God. And we thank you for that tonight, God. We worship you, Lord. You are worthy. You are worthy of all the honor and all the glory and all the praise. You are holy and you are worthy. And we thank you tonight. We thank you tonight that you have sanctified us. Hallelujah. That you have made us your righteousness, God. You have given us your righteousness, God. And now we are the righteousness of God through Christ Jesus. We praise you, God, that you have seated us in heavenly places, God. We praise you, Father God, that you have given us the mind of Christ, Lord. We thank you tonight, God, that you have poured your very spirit on the inside of us, God, and that we are not led of this flesh. We do not walk by this flesh. We are not moved by what we see, God, but we are moved by faith, God. We are moved by your word, and we praise you tonight, God, that we are walking in your favor and walking in your spirit, God, spirit-led, Lord, spirit-led, that you are showing us and teaching us and leading us and guiding us, Father God, and keeping our ears tuned to you, God, in these last days and in these last hours, Lord, for surely, surely, you are soon to come, you are soon to come, hallelujah. And we do not want to miss the glory, God, the glory that will precede your coming, Lord. We do not want to miss this last great outpouring, Father God, of your spirit upon the sons and the daughters, hallelujah, upon all flesh. We do not want to miss, God, what is coming upon us, Father God. So help us, Lord, not just be hearers of the word, God, but let us be doers of the word, Father God, and give us the fear of the Lord that our pastor has been talking about, Father God, for he has said to us that if the fear would come back into the church, that the glory would return to the church. And God, help me long and desire to see your glory, Father God, as Moses cried out to you and said, show me your glory. And even a man, Lord, in the old covenant, you showed your glory, God. So we know how you desire to show your glory to those of us, hallelujah, who have been washed in the blood of the new covenant, Father God. And we praise you tonight, God. We praise you tonight, God. We praise you tonight, Lord, that you are awakening our spirits and awakening us to what you are doing in this last day and in this last hour, God. That we will not slumber and we will not sleep, God. But that we will not miss what is coming, Lord. But that we will be your agents on the earth, God. And that where we go, Lord, your glory will go, Father God. That to a dark and a lost world, Father God, yet your light and your glory will go where we go, God, because you are in us. And where we go, you go, Father God. Now let us walk in the path that you have laid out for us tonight, God. Let us hear your word tonight, God. And let it pierce, God, hallelujah, Shania, into our hearts, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah, dividing us under soul and spirit, God. That whatever we need to do, God, to get ready for this last move, God. Whatever we need to do to be used of you, Father God, that we would hear and we would hearken to your voice, God. And we would be obedient, God. And we would be a bride ready for your coming, Lord. That your bride would be without spot and without wrinkle, Lord. Hallelujah, walking in your power and your glory and your grace, Lord. Hallelujah, taking your love everywhere we go, Lord. We praise you tonight, Father God. We praise you tonight, God. Hallelujah. Just give him worship and give him praise tonight. Hallelujah. As the pastor comes, just give him worship. Give God praise tonight. Hallelujah. For that is what he desires. Praise you tonight, God. We praise you tonight, God. Hallelujah. 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 Glory. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Can we do beautiful? Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. God, we praise you. Hallelujah. Come on, he's in the house. Hallelujah. We didn't come here for any other reason but to worship him and to see him and to hear from him tonight. Hallelujah. We didn't come, for any other reason, for a program or whatever, but we came to see God and to hear from him tonight. Come on. Lift up his name. Hallelujah. I've just been thinking about how that the word talks about how that he is knocking. Amen. He is knocking, that if any would open, that he would come in and sup with them. And I said, God, please, don't in our services, don't let us ever leave you on the outside knocking and not let you in. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Sister Stiltner, I've just been contemplating worship and contemplating church and contemplating things that we do and how we do them, and just thinking about different things. what songs do you want to hear? That's what we need to begin to ask God. What is it that you want to hear? And what is pleasing to you? And it wasn't too long ago in prayer, I heard God speak in my ear, and he said, what if I asked you just to completely change the way you worship? Amen. And I thought, God, I don't even know what that would look like, but if that's what you want, then I want to change it, because I want worship that's not a form and a fashion, but I want worship, hallelujah, that is on fire for him, that is passionate, that worship that is in spirit and in truth. Hallelujah. Praise you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I see your face in every sunrise. The colors of the morning are inside your eyes. The world awakens in the light of the day. I look up to the sky and say, you're beautiful. I see your power in the
Can you see him hanging on the tree? Can you see him hanging there just for you? Huh? That's why he was there. Because of you and me. Is he not beautiful tonight? Can you really see him hanging on the tree for you? If you can't, you need to have the you need to make another trip back to Calvary. Gaze up at the cross. And see that there is a suffering Christ that suffered and bled and died for you. Amen. Amen. Nothing no more beautiful. Calvary was very ugly. There was nothing beautiful about Calvary. Before there was a beautiful Savior hanging on that tree. That gave his life so that we could have life. We take that so for granted, don't we? Sometimes we are so unthankful and so unmoved by what Calvary has accomplished in our lives. Are you still with me? Don't let your mind get distracted right now. We're talking about something very, very, very real tonight. Calvary. Cross. Eternal life. Heaven, hell. Being blessed or being cursed. It all came from Calvary. It all flowed from that cross. Every hope you'll ever have is wrapped up in Calvary. Everything that you are ever hoping to be is wrapped up in Calvary. So thank God it's not who I used to be, it's who I am now. Because his blood covered what I used to be. Hallelujah. And you are what you are now, as the Apostle Paul said, by the grace of God. Amen. Ought not never be a day you raise from your bed, you will not be praising the Lord. Thanking God for the health in your body, for the sound mind, for what you have and what you're going to have. Amen. Praise God. He's an awesome God tonight. Amen. There's a beautiful song there, God. Amen. Touch my heart tonight. That was worth my trip to the house of God tonight just to hear that song tonight.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Because I can see him on the tree. All I got to do is go to the Word of God and begin to read all there is. All I got to do is go right back there to the Gospel and read the writings of those men that were there and begin to write by the inspiration of the Holy Ghost. And they begin to take you back to Calvary. And you can relive it. And every time you read about Calvary, if it doesn't bring tears to our eyes, we need to make another trip back to the cross. Amen. I don't know about you, but I wasn't worthy of all that. I said I wasn't worthy of all that. I thank God I am a recipient of that love. I'm not worthy of anything that he done for me on Calvary, Bobby. Not worthy. I should have been the one on that cross. I should have been the one that died and went to hell, not him. I should have been. But thank God. Thank God that he bore our sickness, carried all of our diseases to Calvary, nailed them to the cross, shed the blood so that we could be forgiven, and walk in this life without any shame, without any guilt, without any condemnation. Now, boys, that's a pretty good deal, if you ask me. I don't know about you, but I had a lot of guilt. And I had a lot of things to be ashamed about. And I pray none of you ever find out what I used to be and what I used to do. Because it's very shameful. But I'm thankful tonight that he took my shame, carried it to Calvary, and nailed it to the cross.
Yes, hallelujah.
And he said, now you don't have to be shameful. You can walk around forgiven. Hallelujah. And I don't allow the devil to take me back to my past. Do you? I don't. Because my past is past. It's exactly where it's going to stay, in the past. It's forever etched out of the mind of God. God doesn't remember it, so why should I? He doesn't bring it up, so why should you? Come on, church, you're awful quiet here tonight. Come on, church, you're awful quiet here tonight. Amen. We got something to rejoice about. Amen. Amen. When you see him on the cross, it ought to bring some joy up on the inside of your heart, knowing that he loves you that much. Amen. Amen. It's an old story, but it never goes on. The church becomes numb to it. We become numb to the reality of Calvary sometimes. Amen. But it should never become commonplace when we talk about Calvary. It'll always bring a praise upon our hearts. Amen. And a tear in our eye when we begin to think about the sufferings that Christ went through for us, for you and me. Amen. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Amen. Can I get a better amen?
Amen.
Oh, hallelujah. Glory to God. A bit more, man. Praise God. All right. Anybody got a praise report before I get started? Once I get started, I ain't going to quit. Now, so you better get it. If I got a praise report, you do. All right, go ahead.
Well, for about 6 months, me and my sister were missionaries every night. We prayed together, but it finally got out to the lady. She's not. And during this process, the reason we started praying was for our family to be saved. Well, during this process, we had two nieces saved.
Two nieces saved, right? Amen. Praise God. That's all right. That's awesome. Amen. Praise God. Amen. Prayer of agreement, huh?
Yes.
Prayer of agreement. Amen. Power in the prayer of agreement.
Oh, yes.
Okay. Amen. Anybody else got a praise report before I get started? Anybody? Once I get started, it will be a while. Anybody? Nobody? Amen. How are you? Are you? You're going to sleep, ain't you? You're so sleepy. He is so sleepy. The rest of them like that too, but they're just acting like another shit. Hey, anybody else got a praise report before I get started? Anybody? Go ahead, Brother Jason.
I just want to thank God and praise God for taking me out of there and putting me in here.
Amen.
That's fake. It's true.
Amen. 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 Praise God. Amen. Praise God. That'll be worth the trip to the house of God right there. Amen. Praise God. Anybody else? Got to pray before we get started. Anybody? While you're making up your mind, go to 2 Corinthians chapter 3. Anybody else got to pray before?
I want to give the Lord praise.
Where you at? All right.
Tomorrow this speech comes out, and I just want to just praise God this morning.
Amen. 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 Anybody else? Are y'all all right tonight?
Amen.
Y'all act all off of a bunch of depressed people in this house tonight. I need to pray the spirit of depression out of this place or what? Huh? What, is it on you? Is it? Father, right now in Jesus' name, I plead the blood over my brother right now. I bind this spirit of depression. It's a spirit straight out of hell. It has come to discourage us. And it's come to try to turn us from the promises of God. But your promises are yea and amen in you. And tonight I'm believing for the word of the living God to come alive in this man of God's life. I bind the thoughts God the enemy is binding his mind. I bind them right now in Jesus' name. We cast down every imagination. We cast down every thought. We bring into the captivity of the obedience of Christ. We're believing the word of God to come alive in this man's life. I'm believing right now for a job, glory to God. A job that you have already picked out. You got your finger on it, and this man of God is going to walk into the favor of God and believe that to come to pass in Jesus' mighty, 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 mighty name. Amen. Praise God. Glory to God. Bind that devil in Jesus' name. Bind that devil in Jesus' name. What's up? You bind him. Hey, if you bind it here, it'll be bound in heaven. If you loose it, it'll be loose in heaven. Amen. He said, it's his good pleasure to give you the keys of the kingdom. And the keys are all about binding and loosening. But if you never bind it and loose it, it ain't going to be bound and loosed, is it? Come on, somebody, talk to me. It ain't meant for you to walk around here depressed. Depression is a spirit. You must conquer it in the spiritual realm. You must bind it and put it where it needs to be, under your feet. You've got too much to be thankful for to be depressed. All you've got to do is look around and see yourself, and you can understand why you ought not be depressed. Now, if you stay depressed, it's your choice to stay depressed, but you can come out of that thing. Amen. I believe that. I don't believe we ought to walk around depressed and discouraged. Amen. God can't do a whole lot with a discouraged person. Amen. You need to quit discouraging the encourager. The encourager is the Holy Ghost. And we discourage our encourager by walking around discouraged. We got too much to be encouraged about. This is the best time there ever was to be in the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. The best things are yet to come. He saved the best wine to last. I wish I had somebody that would help me up. Hey, I said he saved the best wine to last. And the last shall be first, glory to God. And the best things are ahead for the church. Amen. I believe that, don't you? I believe that. Glory to God. Amen. I just think I'll just go ahead and just go ahead. Amen. Let's go ahead. Are you in 2 Corinthians chapter 3?
Yes.
Are you? Now, see, some of you ain't got no Bible. Now, y'all think I'm reading from the Fuse and Roebuck catalog. Amen. Can you actually see that little print in there? You got good glasses, ain't you? Praise God. Amen. 2 Corinthians chapter number 3 tonight. All right. Nobody else got nothing else to say. I got a whole lot to say. Amen. Anybody else before I get started? If not, forever holds your peace, because I'm going to shoot you tonight with both barrels. All right? All right?
Amen.
Is it all right?
Yes.
They that wait upon the Lord shall walk. Amen. They shall mount up with wings as who?
Eagle.
Amen. The eagle always soars. Eagle always gets above the problem, above the storm. The eagle will sit there and look the storm in the eye, looking right dead in the face. He's look right in the eye of the storm.
Amen.
And waits till the storm gets strong enough, till the wind begins to blow. And that old eagle will begin to soar. He'll spend 90% soaring and 10% flapping. But we spend 90% flapping, 10% trying to soar. Come on, talk to me, somebody. Exactly right. Amen. The eagle knows how to get above the storm. He don't spend all of his time flapping. He don't spend all of his time trying to get out. He knows how to get in the wind. God, that'll preach right there. He knows how to get in the wind. The breath. Hallelujah. Began to soar above the storm. The storm doesn't get him, but he gets above the storm. Amen. Come on, somebody. Talk to the preacher now. I ain't where I'm going now. It just comes to mind. Eagles, a lot of things about the Bible talk about the eagle, man. It's just awesome. We've been to study about the eagle. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, is that what your Bible says? I cannot see nothing in your Bible. It's just a bit blurred. I can't see that. That's little bitty print for little bitty babies to read. I'm a man. I can't read little bitty print. Amen. 2 Corinthians chapter number 3 tonight. All right. We have been talking about the fear of the Lord, right? We've been getting some understanding of what it means to walk in and to live in the fear of the Lord. Amen. But one thing I hope you've learned through this, when we talk about the fear of the Lord, we're not talking about being scared of God. We're not talking about being afraid of God. That's not what we're talking about, right? We talk about the fear of the Lord. Let me give you one more scripture. Let me give you the scripture one more time. We've went over it many times, but we're going to go over it again tonight. But we'll keep it before you until this gets in you. And once it gets in you, I'll take a break, and then I'll do it again. Isaiah chapter 33. Let's go. Isaiah chapter 33, verse 5, verse 6. Let me read this to you. It's on the screen. I want you to second with me. Here we go. The Lord is exalted, for he dwells on high. He will fill Zion with his justice and righteousness. He will be the sure foundation for
your
time. Whose time?
My time.
Who's your time? Who's your time? Some of you are kind of mumbling. He's a sure foundation for whose times? Our times. Look at it. He is a sure foundation for your times, a rich store of salvation and wisdom and knowledge. Look at that. The fear of the Lord is the key to this treasure. Look at that one more time. Notice the foundation for our times is built on who? It's built on the Lord Jesus Christ, right? In him there is a rich store of salvation and wisdom and knowledge. And the key to that is the fear of the Lord. The fear of the Lord is the key to this treasure. Is anybody interested in this treasure?
Amen.
The treasure of salvation, wisdom, and knowledge. It is in wrapped up in the fear of the Lord. It's wrapped up in our understanding of and walking in the fear of the Lord. Because now it becomes our foundation. Without the proper foundation, whatever we build, if the foundation is not right, it will not stand. Except the Lord build the house, they that labor, labor in vain. Except the Lord build the house, they that labor, labor in vain. The foundation must be right. The foundation must be right. If our foundation is not built on Christ, who is the cornerstone, our foundation will be all wrong. If we want to unlock the treasure of wisdom, of salvation, and knowledge, it's wrapped up in the fear of the Lord. Knowing and understanding what the fear of the Lord is and walking in the fear of the Lord. Amen. Not being scared of God, not being afraid of God, but allowing the fear of God to take us closer to God. Because the fear of the Lord will take us, will allow us to get in a position where we can get closer to God. Amen. Now this past Sunday, a lot of you wasn't here, but this past Sunday we talked about the blessings of fearing God. And man, there's a lot of them in the book of Isaiah. There's a lot of them in this word. And we went over a lot of scripture here Sunday, and we talked about God's promises that comes as a result of fearing God. Comes as a result of living in and understanding and walking in the fear of the Lord. Folks, there's a lot of blessings attached to that. I didn't realize how many blessings there was attached to the fear of the Lord until I got my Bible, until I got my concordance out, and I began to go through that and began to look at all the scriptures that dealt with the fear of the Lord. And it is unreal, the number of scriptures or the number of blessings that is attached to the fear of the Lord. And there's simply too many to try to cover. It's such a broad spectrum. It is unreal at the blessings that come when we begin to walk in and understand the fear of the Lord. Amen. The word is rich, is it not?
Yes.
I said it's rich.
Amen.
And when we began to talk about the blessings that came from the fear of the Lord this past Sunday morning, I'm telling you, the blessings of the Lord was so rich and it was so real. I'm telling you, what's in God's food? I went home Sunday. I still could not believe the blessings that is attached to the fear of the Lord. And we didn't cover just a very, very small portion of what that Bible reveals about the blessing. I had never seen that before in my entire ministry. I've never really got in there and looked at this thing, how many blessings are attached to the fear of the Lord. Never have I seen that. It is unreal what we are missing out on when we don't understand how to walk in God's way. Not in the church's way. Not in the doctrine that the church has set up. Not in some man-made doctrine. Not in some church. But as we follow the Lord and we begin to understand the fear of the Lord, the blessings that comes out of that, it's unreal. Every blessing that would cover your entire being, body, soul, and spirit, is wrapped up in understanding and walking in the fear of the Lord. Amen. When anybody says amen, or not, I say amen for you. Glory to God. Now watch that. What? Let's go. Tonight I want to go a little bit deeper into this thing, in the fear of the Lord. All right. Now we've talked about how that the word reveals prophetically that the latter glory is going to be greater than the former, right? Anybody remember that?
Yeah.
We've been over that I don't know many times. We talked about how that the latter and the former rain is going to come together, and we're going to the Lord is going to there's going to be a great end time harvest and souls take place in these latter times. All right, everybody remember that?
Amen.
After God establishes His divine order, which includes restoring the fear of the Lord back into the church. And back into the people's lives, everyday lives. Once the order is established, then His revealed glory can come. And any irreverence or lack of fear or any disrespect that meets the revealed glory, it will be met with immediate judgment. The greater the glory, the greater the judgment will be. Got me? Got me. I said, have you got me?
Amen.
Okay. Let's start in 2 Corinthians chapter 3 tonight. 2 Corinthians chapter 3 is just going to tie in with what we've already discussed. But I want you to notice even the Apostle Paul began to talk about it. 2 Corinthians chapter 3. Paul is talking about the glory of the old covenant versus the glory of the new covenant. Paul talked about it. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, drop down to verse 7 and verse 8. Verse 7. But if the ministry of death, written and engraved on stones, was glorious, so that the children of Israel could not look steadily at the face of Moses because of the glory of his countenance, which glory was passing away, how will the ministry of the Spirit not be more glorious? Now let me break this down where we can understand this. Alright? Notice verse 7 and verse 8. Look at it, because I'm going to break it down to where we can all grab it. Paul is talking about the old system. Talking about the law. When he talks about the ministry of death. And he talks about how that the law was etched in stone and it led to death. He called it the ministry of death. Yet Paul said, it began with such glory that the children of Israel could not look at upon the face of Moses. The Bible reveals that the face of Moses shone so bright with the glory of God that it shone with the brightness. And Moses said that brightness was already fading away. Look at verse 8. And then he said, should we expect far greater glory when the Holy Spirit is giving life? Moses said, or God said, or Paul said, that Moses was on the mountain. The glory came. There was such a brightness and glory upon Moses that when he come off of the mountain, he had to put a veil over his face because of the glory. Moses said that glory was so bright then, but that glory that was of the former glory was fading away. And then he said in verse 8, should not you and I, under this new covenant, expect a far greater glory when the Holy Spirit is giving life? Can I get an amen?
Amen.
When you go back to the book of Exodus, Moses was on the mountain with God. And the Bible says that Moses talked with God as a man would talk with his friend. And when Moses came down off of the mountain, the Bible says that his face became the brilliance of the brightness of the one that he had been with. And the people, the children of Israel, became afraid of Moses. They were frightened. Why were they frightened? Look on the screen. Moses' countenance reflected he had been in the presence. He had been in the glory of Almighty God. When you're in the presence or when you're in the glory of Almighty God, there is a change that takes place. I said when you've been in the glory of God, when you've been in the presence of God, there's a change that takes place. Moses' countenance had changed. Moses' countenance had reflected the one that he had been in the presence of, he'd been in the glory of, and that was a living God. Now listen to what I'm going to say. Under the new covenant, you and I, that's us. God's plan is not for us to reflect His glory, but for His glory to be seen in us. Hallelujah. I said under the new covenant, God's plan is not for us to reflect His glory, but that the glory of God might be seen in every one of us. It's one thing to reflect something, but it's another thing to abide in it. Glory to God. And God wants us to abide in His presence. He wants us to abide in His glory. Can I get an amen for somebody? And hear this preacher tonight. It is God's will. It is God Himself. It is His plan. Not for us to reflect His glory, but for you and I to abide in His glory. So that His glory can be seen in and through us. Come on, somebody talk to me. Wherever you go, wherever I go, we ought to be walking in the glory. Wherever we go, wherever I go, wherever you go, we ought to be walking in His presence. Amen. People ought to see the glory in us. People ought to see His reflection in us. It is His plan that we not reflect Him, but it is His plan for Him to be seen in every one of us. Anywhere and everywhere we go, we carry Him, and we ought to display who's on the inside of us. It ought to be His glory. It ought to be His anointing. It ought to be His presence. There ought to be something different about the people of God. And the thing that's different about the people of God is the God that's alive on the inside of them. Just like Moses counted with saints, you and I, our countenance ought to be changed. Our way ought to be changed. Our desires ought to be changed. We ought to, His glory, God's plan is for His glory to be seen in us. Amen. But the only way the glory can be revealed in us is that the fear of the Lord be established with God's divine order before the glory can be revealed. The glory can't be revealed until we begin to establish the fear of the Lord.
Amen.
Boys, it is graveyard quiet in this house tonight. If anybody sees 089 pulling out there, lock the doors. Are you still with me? His design, His plan, is for His glory to be revealed in us. But until we understand the fear of the Lord, His glory cannot be revealed because His divine order is not been established. Am I making any sense? Moses, his countenance reflected the one in whom he had been with, which was the glory. And his face began to reveal what he was in. And the children of Israel became afraid of Moses. Now watch what Paul said. We don't say, look, I'm not done here. Now watch verse 10 and 11. Look what Paul went on to say. Now stay with me just a few minutes. Verse 10 and 11. Paul went on. Let me read. For even what was made glorious had no glory in this respect, because of the glory that excels. For if what is passing away was glorious, verse 11, what remains is much more glorious. Good God Almighty. For if what is passing away was glorious, what remains is much more glorious. For if what is passing away was glorious, what remains is much more glorious. Paul was saying the first glory was not glorious at all compared to the overwhelming glory of the new covenant. Let me get verse 11. I don't think it's up there. For if what is passing away was glorious, what remains is much more glorious. He was saying, you think it was glorious under the old covenant, Moses on the mountain with God, and that glory was fading away. And Paul said, compared to the overwhelming glory that is of the new covenant, it don't even compare. See, we can't grab that. We just can't believe that with our religious mindset. We can't grab that. We can't by faith walk in that. We can't by faith believe that. But the Word can't lie. We have a problem believing the Word. God Almighty. Paul said the latter is going to be greater than the former. God, I wish we could believe that. I wish we could latch a hold of that. That's not the only place. That's about the third or fourth place we've revealed the same thing in the Word of God. That everything be established by the mouth of two or three witnesses. We've already got three or four witnesses of the same thing. And yet we still struggle to believe what we're reading from the Word of God. Good God Almighty. Man, I'll tell you something right now. I don't know about you, but I am so thankful that I've been brought into the kingdom at such a time as this. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. Look what Paul said. He said, even though the glory of the old covenant did not compare the glory of the new covenant, look what he said. He said the old was still awesome. It was still awesome. And Paul reiterates it. Look at verse 13. He reiterates what he said. He said Israel could not look steadily at the end of what was passing away. Good. Think about that. Think about that, the glory of the old covenant. Think about that. Paul said it was still awesome. But he said in verse 13, he said Israel could not look steadily at the end of what was passing away. Good Lord, amen. The glory of the old, think about that. And think about this. If you really can, think about this. Think about that former glory. And the latter is going to be greater than the former. I like that, preacher. I don't know if I can believe all that, but I like it. I like it. He didn't make that up. He got that out of your Bible. That's what your Bible says is going to happen. As glorious as that was, that experience with Moses was, that was the former. The latter is going to be great. The former was awesome. Yes, it was. Oh, God. I mean, Moses come over that mountain with a gleam, man. He come out of that mud. He come over that mud. God, he come up over that mountain with a glow on him, with a brightness on him, that he had to put a veil over that thing to diffuse the glory that was upon him. And Paul said that was the former thing. The latter thing is going to be greater than what you see in the former. Good God Almighty. Man, I can't wait. Glory. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. Are you still with me in this building tonight? Amen. Glory to God. Amen. Now watch this. Look at verse 14. Now Paul quickly says in verse 14, now talking about the children of Israel, now, talking about those that was there with Moses. He said verse 14, but their minds were hardened. King James says, but their minds were blinded. Their minds were blinded. Stay with me now. Stay with me. Notice what happened. They couldn't see the very thing that they needed so desperately. Oh, God. Honey, I can preach that right now because that's exactly where we are in the present certain. They couldn't see what they needed so desperately. What they needed was on Moses, and they couldn't see what they needed so desperately. And we can find ourselves in the same place they were. What we need so desperately is the glory. We don't need another sermon. We don't need another preacher. We don't need another song signing. We don't need to schedule this or schedule that. What we need so desperately is what they could not see they needed, and that was the glory.
Amen.
Hallelujah. That was the glory. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
All right, look at verse 14. Let me read it. I don't know if it's going to be on the screen or not. Probably won't. I grabbed this. I said, I'm going to go. Verse 14. Let me ramble on here. Look at verse 14. But their minds were hardened. For until this day, the same veil remains unlifted in the reading of the Old Testament, because the veil is taken away in Christ. Verse 15, for even to this day when Moses is read, look at this, a veil lies on their heart. Nevertheless, when one turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. Good God, I like that. Nevertheless, when one turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. Watch now, watch. Paul warns us so that you and I, in this hour, so that we won't find ourselves blind and in the same dilemma. He said in verse 14, look, he said their minds were blinded. Well, how were their minds blinded? How were their minds blinded? What they lacked is what we lacked, and which is necessary in order for us to walk in God's glory. They with me now. They with me. Why was their minds blinded? What did they lack that we also lack that is so needful for us to walk in the glory?
Fear.
Go back to Exodus. Let's go. Turn your Bibles back there. Exodus chapter number 19. Go back over and find, get your Bible and get back over to the book of Exodus. Easy book to find. Easy book to find. Talk about the second book in the Bible. That ain't too hard either. Amen. All right, now let's go. Are you still with me?
Amen.
I don't know if y'all are or not. I think y'all are asleep when you come here tonight. Amen. All right. I know. Exodus chapter number 19. Watch now. Israel had just left Egypt. All right. And Moses had led them to Mount Sinai, where God would reveal His glory. Watch them. Watch. Watch what they lack. Watch. Watch how, why their minds were blinded. Exodus chapter 19, verse 10 and verse 11. Then the Lord said to Moses, go to the people, sanctify them today and tomorrow, and let them wash their clothes. And let them be ready for the third day. For on the third day, the Lord will come down upon Mount Zion in the sight of all the people. That's on the third day. Now watch now. The message was a prophetic word spoken to Moses' day. But it also is a prophetic revelation for us right now. Stay with me just for a moment. Notice what the people had to do before God would manifest His glory. They were to sanctify themselves. Verse 10. Did you see that?
Amen.
They were to sanctify themselves. Now this is a strange thing, but this included them washing their clothes. Well, praise God. Think about that just for a moment. Because they were told specifically to wash their clothes. Sanctify themselves outwardly and inwardly. Watch now. Washing their clothes. symbolic to us. How, preacher? We are to consecrate ourselves. Our garments are to be cleansed of the filth of the world. Second Corinthians chapter 6, put it up there, Heather, right quick. And what agreement have the temple of God with idols? For you are the temple of the living God. As God said, I will dwell in them and walk among them. I will be their God and they shall be my people. Come out from among them and be separate, says the Lord. Do not touch what is unclean and I will receive you. And I will be a father to you and you shall be my sons and daughters, says the Lord Almighty. Therefore, having these promises, beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. Symbolically, when they were to wash their clothes, symbolically for us, our garments are to be cleansed from the filthiness of this world. We sang the song a while ago. We are to become His bride without spot. We are to become His bride without spot. Ephesians 5:27. That He might present it being the church, it being the bride, that He might present it Himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that it should be holy and without blemish. They were to sanctify themselves, and that included washing their clothes. Sanctified, set apart, and made holy, or set apart to receive the glory. Before God could manifest His glory, they had to sanctify themselves. I think we all can understand that God cannot reveal His glory in a person that refuses to sanctify themselves from the world. I don't really believe that any of us believe that God can reveal His glory to a person that will not come out from among the world. I don't really believe that we can expect God to reveal His glory in a liberal church. I was thinking off my mind. Amen. They were to sanctify themselves, and that included washing their outer garments. Wow. And now we're trying to get the glory. We're trying to get the glory by any way but the right way. We're trying to pay the preacher to get it. We're trying to get the TV preacher to send us the right quotient or the right quota or the right potion in order for it to, you know, abracadabra here and abracadabra there. We're trying to get the glory in an unsanctified way. And it won't work. The glory of God cannot be revealed until the people of God learn how to walk in the fear of God, and that includes sanctifying themselves and being consecrated to God and separate ourselves from the filthiness of this old world. Yes. Jason just stood a while ago and said, I praise God, thank God that He brought me from out there into here. Because there's nothing out there, but everything's in here. And what he's talking about is in here is in the Word of God. It's in God Himself. It is in His Word, in His promise, in His hope. It is sanctifying ourselves and getting ready, ourselves ready for the glory of God that will be revealed in these latter times. The latter is going to be greater than the former, but we cannot expect the latter to be greater than the former if we are trying to operate in an unsanctified way. Preach on, preach. I feel like an old-time holiness preacher tonight. I'm all by myself now. That's all right, glory to God. I can't squeeze an amen out of anybody, but I'm still going to talk about sanctification. I'm still going to talk about consecration. I'm still going to talk about the way of holiness. It's a highway of holiness, and no unclean thing shall enter thereon. Glory to God. It's still a holy life. Glory to God. We've got to walk it. We've got to talk it. We've got to live it. It's by the way of holiness that God will reveal His glory. He will not reveal His glory any other way. And when we learn how to fear the Lord and walk in the fear of the Lord, the glory will be revealed, because now we've learned how to sanctify ourselves and walk in the holiness of Almighty God. Preach on, preach. Preach on, preach. Okay, I've got to settle down now. Settle down, preacher. You're getting your blood pressure all worked up, getting all worked up, sweating. You haven't gone to take another shower. I ain't taking no shower. Help myself sweat. Are you still with me? I said, are you still with me? Are you still with me? Okay. Once they what? They were to sanctify themselves, right? Okay, now watch, now watch. Come on now. Are you still? Come on, come back to me. Come back to me. Remember the scripture that we've been over here for a couple Sundays in a row, Wednesday night and Sunday. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse number 8. Remember that scripture right there? That one day with the Lord is 1,000 years. And 1,000 years as one day. Remember that? You don't need to write that down. You already know that. You already got that wrote down here. Remember that, anybody? Amen. Caroline, you wrote that down 100 times. You don't need to write that down. One day with the, she only knows one scripture. That's if a man don't work, he don't eat. That's all she does. I retired back in 2010. I ain't eating meals since 2010. She said, forget about John 3:16. You ain't working, you eat. Okay, got me? One day with the Lord is 1,000 years. 1,000 years is one day, right? Okay. Remember the scripture that went back and grabbed hold of in Hosea? Remember that scripture? I believe it's Hosea, wasn't it? Hosea chapter number 6, verse number 2. Remember that scripture? After 2 days, he will revive us. And on the third day, he will raise us up that we may live in his sight. Anybody remember that scripture right there? Anybody remember that?
Yeah.
2 days, he will revive us. Okay. Prophetically, going from 2 Peter, we are in the second day prophetically, right?
Yeah.
It's been over 2,000 years since Jesus Christ was crucified, buried, and rose from the very dead, right? 2,000 years ago. So his reviving includes us to sanctify ourselves. His reviving includes us to consecrate ourselves. His reviving includes us to set ourselves apart from the world. Why would he require that? He's doing that in preparation for his glory. Our garments are to be cleansed. Our garments are to be washed from the filth of this world. We are to become his bride without spot. After 2,000 years, he will again manifest his glory. And the good news of it is, we've been in the second day now for some time. And the good news of it is, he's still sanctifying his people. And we're still setting ourselves apart because he's getting ready and wanting and desiring to reveal his glory. And he's just about ready to reveal his glory because he said on the third day, I will raise you up. Good God Almighty. On the third day, he'll raise us up. Why? That we might live in his sight. Church, listen to this preacher. Look at me. Look at me. I know I'm preaching to the choir, but it really don't make me no never mind. I really don't care who I'm preaching to as long as I got somebody to preach to. If there's ever an hour that we ever need to make up our mind that we're going to sanctify ourselves and stay out of the world and stay out of the problems of the world and stay out of the world itself, we need to make up our mind right now because we are in the second day and the third day is on the horizon. When the third day comes, he's going to raise us up. His glory is going to be revealed and the latter is going to be greater than the former. And I'm not going to be hooked up with a bunch of people that refuse to sanctify themselves and come out of the world and not be identified with the world but be identified with the bride. Hallelujah. And he's coming after a bride without spot and without wrinkle. If we've ever determined to sanctify ourselves and live right and live godly and live holy, we got to make up our mind right now because we're in the second day of this thing and the third day is on the horizon, glory to God. And we're just about ready for the glory to be revealed. Man, I feel excited. I know you ain't, but I am excited. I wish I had somebody to say I'm excited too. I don't believe that, but I'll take it for it. Watch now. What? Watch what happens here. Watch now. Come on, stay. Come on. Are you still with me? Watch what happens on the morning of the third day with the children of Israel. Look at this, man. Exodus chapter 19, verse 16 through 18. Look what happened on the third day. Verse 16 on Exodus 19. Then it came to pass on the third day, in the morning of the third day. Hallelujah. Does that sound familiar? I read in the Bible where somebody else got up in the morning on the third day. Early morning. Before that's all right, y'all be all right. Then it came to pass on the third day in the morning that there was thunderings and lightnings. Look at this. And a thick cloud on the mountain. And the sound of the trumpet was very loud, so that all the people who were in the camp trembled. And Moses brought the people out of the camp to meet with God, and they stood at the foot of the mountain. Now Mount Sinai was completely in smoke, because the Lord descended upon it in fire. Its smoke ascended like the smoke of a furnace, and the whole mountain quaked greatly. My God. Look what happened on the third morning. On the third day. God manifested himself. Not only by sight, but also by his voice. When Moses spoke, the Lord answered him in the hearing of every one of those people. Are you listening to me? Are you hearing?
Yeah.
Are you got me? On the third day, prophetically, listen to me. He's going to raise us up. And the latter will be greater than the former. God spoke then, and God will speak again. God manifested himself then, and God will manifest himself again in a greater glory than he did in the former glory. Now, I don't know about you, but I read all about that right there, what happened on the third day there, and the third day in the new covenant in our day, and the latter is going to be greater than that. I don't want to miss it. I don't want to miss it. If all that took place on the third day, and those people saw and heard, I want to be among them that see and hear. Because not everybody going to see and hear. Yeah. There's going to be some that do as these did. I'm getting ahead of myself, and I'll be back there again in a minute. There's going to be some do like these did. Instead of running to him, they'll run from him. Because if you're not sanctified, I don't want to go there to a preacher. If you're not sanctified, and you're not walking in the fear of the Lord, then you're not going to go. You're not going to want to go into the glory.
Amen.
Because they died. He get carried away. He's on. He's preached his own little sermon. He's on. He's preached 45 minutes after arriving in the body. He's still preaching. He's a hack and do, boy. He got that hack in him. That's all right, brother. You got him, man. Go fire. Get you high five. Still with me? Are you still with me, Larry? Oh, I'm going to do a tag team on. Are y'all still with us? Watch now. Watch. The third day. Now, watch what happens. Now, watch this. Watch. Watch how the people respond. Flip over to Exodus chapter 20. Look at verse 18. Part of verse 18. Look at that. Notice the reaction of the people. Now all the people witnessed the thunders and lightnings and flashes. You hear that? They witnessed the sound of the trumpet. They saw the mountain smoking. When the people saw it, they trembled and stood far off. Then they said to Moses, "You speak with us, and we will hear. But let not God speak with us, lest we die." And Moses said to the people, verse 20, "Do not fear, for God has come to test you, and that his fear may be before you, so that you may not sin." Now notice the people, now they trembled and they drew back, right? So that tells us that they were afraid of God. They no longer wanted to hear God. They wanted nothing to do with his audible voice. And neither did they want to look upon or be in the presence of his glory. Amen. Why? Because they were unable to bear the glory. Look at verse 20 one more time. Moses, in verse 20, told the people, "Do not fear, for God has come to test you, and that his fear may be before you so that you may not sin." Moses very quickly warned the people, "Do not fear, do not fear, do not fear. Come back into the presence of God. Come back, don't run, come back." Moses said, "God is just testing you, come back." But they wanted nothing to do with the glory. Ah, God. And Moses told the people, God has come to test you. Don't run from the glory, run to the glory.
Amen.
So if God tested them, you know that he's going to test us, right? Amen. So why did God test us? To see what's in our heart? No, he already knows what's in our heart. He tests us so that we might know what's in our hearts. And most people, most of the time, don't look at certain things as a test.
Amen.
Because they don't like what's revealed about them while they're in the test. Amen, preacher.
Amen.
God uses certain things and certain people to come into our lives. Come to me now. And He expects us to say no. God will put things before us to test us, and before the test comes, He expects us to say no to certain things. And He's not testing us for Him to know what's in us. He's testing us to see what's in us. Just like He tested the children of Israel right here on Mount Sinai with His glory. Do you understand that God wanted to make all the children of Israel kings and priests? Everyone. He wanted them all to be like Moses. Every one of them. He wanted them all to come into His glory. Not just Moses. Just like He wants the church today, He wants all of His body to come to His. He wants all of His body to be sanctified and set apart for the glory to be revealed in our lives. Oh, how He longs! How He must! Sometimes His heart must break. Sometimes as He watches the church in this hour, as we struggle and as we stagger along this walk that we go in. Can I get an amen from somebody?
Amen.
Amen. Praise God. Now look here. Mount Sinai, what was the purpose of the test? Here it is. Here it is. Here's the purpose. For them to know whether or not they feared God. And believe it or not, that's the same test He gives us. Because if we really fear Him, we won't make... if we really fear Him, we won't do some of the things we do. Preacher, I don't believe a Christian would fornicate, do you? I believe when God tests us like that, I believe He tests us to make sure this, because well, I'm just going to go ahead and test you. Dumbo, El Dumbo. And He puts the test before us to reveal to us that we really fear the Lord. Oh, I love the Lord with all my heart. How many times have you heard that? And yet, people are not walking in the fear of the Lord. If they're not walking in the fear of the Lord, they don't love the Lord. I heard a minister say, it don't matter when or where, I can't tell you when or where. But the statement was this individual that they were getting ready to go to the cemetery, the bury this individual. And the pastor said about the individual that this individual called her name and said, they love the Lord with all their heart. And the Holy Spirit quickened me right then in that church sitting on the pew. Right then, He quickened my heart that quick. And He said, I heard Him say that. He said, how many people you really believe really loves me with all their heart? Really? Loves me with all their heart. Think about that now. Think about that. I got that for you, dude. He spoke it to me for me to look at myself, not you. For me to look at myself. How many people really love me with all their heart? Really with all their heart? Really know with all their heart? Very few. I struggle in areas of with my own life at times. And I look back over my life and I say, I can't say that I do all the time. Oh boy, it's going to get quiet now. It's graveyard quiet now, glory to God. It's graveyard quiet now. We are still in the second day of revival. Are you listening to Him? Preparing us to the day that when we will love Him with all of our heart. Because the third day's coming. Oh, this is good. I love this. The third day's coming. And when the third day comes, He's going to raise us up. That we may live. Amen. Praise God. Are you still with me?
Amen.
Are you still with me? Y'all want me to quit? I know you do, but I can't quit right now. Do you want me to quit? Say no, somebody.
No.
Say no, somebody. I don't want you to quit me. Right. What's that one? What? If they fear God, Moses said, look at verse, what verse is that? Look at verse 20. Is that verse 20? Look at verse 20. Look at that. Moses said, if they feared him, they would not sin, right? Mm-hmm. Look on the screen. Because when we draw away from him, sin is always the result. Right?
Yeah.
Always. That's without exception. Sin is always the result when we withdraw from him. Alright? Verse 20, Moses said, do not fear, for God has come to test you, and that his fear may be before you so that you may not sin. Now check this out. What? Look at this. Moses said, do not fear. Look at verse 20 now. He said, do not fear. Then he said, God has come that he may, that his fear may be before you. Now watch here. What? When you look at that, there is a clear distinction right there between being afraid of God and fearing God. And Moses told the people that his fear may be before you. God was teaching them, trying to show them how to walk in the fear of the Lord. Because he was revealing his glory. And he wanted them to receive the same glory that Moses received. And instead of them walking in the fear of God, they became afraid of God. Because of their, well, I can't go into all the reasons why, but very rebellious bunch of people. They were to sanctify themselves, and they were no more sanctified than the world sanctified at the time. Amen. Watch them. Watch. Church, listen to me. Listen to me. There's a difference in being afraid of God and fearing God. I want you to understand that. God is not to be, He doesn't want us to be afraid of him or scared of him. He's our Father. He loves us. Amen. He'll love you like nobody else loved you. He'll give you what nobody else will give you. Amen. And when you sin, he forgives you. All you got to do is ask. And right back in fellowship. If you're sincere about the repentance, you're right back in fellowship, man. You're right out. You're out and you're right back in. Can anybody with me? Anybody hear what I'm saying? Don't be scared of God. Wow. Now before I got saved, I was scared of God. I was. I was scared of going to hell. Look at me. I'm big chicken. When it comes to eternity and hell, I was a scared man. I was. I didn't know idea what fear of the Lord was. I feared God, but in a scared way. Because I'm telling you, there was a fear of hell in me. Always was. Always was. And I remember some of them old preachers I come to now, God, man. They'd preach hell so hot. You're scared to death. You're going to hell while you're sitting in the turkey. I ain't kidding. My God, the flames of hell. I'm surprised the church didn't burn down. Some of them break. I'm telling you right now, some of them old timers. My God. They scared. Well, I started saying they scared the hell out of me, but I was too lost of it. But I had a fear of hell. I feared God, but it was a scared fear. I was afraid. But after I got born again, after I made Jesus my Lord, I feared God, but it was in a totally different way now. I didn't no longer fear hell or didn't fear death. Can you explain it? Can anybody explain it? Can anybody put this in words? I can't no more explain the fear of God in words than I can explain how a cow can eat green grass and give white milk. I cannot explain how. That's a black cow. A black cow can eat green grass and give white milk. I can't explain that no more than I can explain the fear of God. I know that something happens on the inside of a person when they get born again. Something takes place. And the fear changes. I don't know why I'm there, but I got to get away from that. Can I hurry and try to get this done? I'm not going to get this done. Can I try to get it done anyway?
Amen.
Can I? How many of you understand there's a difference between being afraid of God and the fear of God?
Amen.
Moses feared God, grew close to God. The children of Israel were afraid of God, but they grew back from God. Look at verse 21 right quick. Let me read verse 21. Verse 21. So the people stood afar off, but Moses drew near to the thick darkness where God was. Notice the response. Look at the difference. Israel drew back. Moses drew near. We have the same response today, right? Some draw back, some draw near. And God tests us to see if we fear Him, because if we're living in the fear of the Lord, we will choose His will. And when we choose His will, it will keep us out of sin. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
That does not mean you'll be sinless, but the will of God will keep you out of walking in the fear. Listen to me. Walking in the fear of the Lord will keep you out of sin. It will. It'll keep you out of sin. It'll keep you safe when you understand how to walk in the fear of the Lord. Amen. Because you will not go, you will not do things and go places where you're not supposed to be going and who you're supposed to be going with. Can you get an amen?
Amen.
All right. Now, here's something for you to meditate on. Let me give you this and I'll think about letting you out here. I said think about it. Now think about this. The Israelites, what's that? Why? They were no strangers to God's miracles, right? They saw His miracle working power. They saw His delivering power, had delivered them from one enemy after the other, after the other, after the other. He miraculously provided food from heaven, right? Manna from heaven. Miraculously caused water to come out of a rock. Out of a rock. And they saw that. And they would celebrate. They would sing. They would dance. Wow. When He would move miraculously, I mean, man, they had a Pentecostal fit. They would dance. They would shout. They would sing. They would praise Him. Look at these scriptures. Exodus chapter 15, verse 1. Look here. Then Moses and the children of Israel sang the song to the Lord and spoke, saying. Now, watch this now. I will seek the Lord, for He has trampled gloriously the horse and his rider. He has thrown into the sea. Look at verse 20. Here's some of the song. Then Miriam the prophet's sister Aaron took the timbrel in her hand. All the women went out after her with timbrels and with dances. I mean, when God would move miraculously in their behalf, they would sing, they would dance, they would praise Him. I mean, they would have a praise service. God, they would just have offered. I mean, man, they would absolutely praise God for everything that they had in them. But here's what I want you to see. Notice, here's what I want you to see. Notice how they were drawn to His miraculous manifestation, because they benefited from those manifestations. But when the glory of God was revealed, they became scared and they drew back. But they didn't draw back when he was manifesting His provision. They didn't draw back when He was making water come out of the rock. They didn't draw back when those provisions benefited them. They didn't have no problem, did they? None whatsoever. They sang, they danced, they waved their hands. That sound familiar to anybody? But now when the glory was revealed, what happened to them? The same people that was dancing and praising God for His miraculous miracles and provision that He had for them. Now all of a sudden when the glory came, they got scared and drew back. That's going to happen. Not everybody's going to go into the glory. Now then people keep showing up for the benefits they can get out of it. Just like they did with Jesus when they followed Jesus for the healings and the food for their bellies. And there'll be some come just for what benefits they can get out of the church. Oh, preach on, preach on. But not everybody's going to go into the glory. Many are going to do exactly what the children of Israel did. They're going to draw back. They're going to become scared and draw back because they do not walk in the fear of the Lord. They don't remain sanctified. They don't be set apart. And the fear of the Lord, they're not operating and living in. They don't understand it. And so therefore, they're not going to go into the glory. They're going to shrink back. Draw back. Maybe even leave the church. That church is getting too radical for me now. I can't handle that. No, sir. They're too radical now. I can't get into all that. All that ain't necessary. All that ain't necessary. It ain't necessary. They don't need all that stuff. My God, my man, I'm going to do it. You people are crazy. They don't need all that stuff. They don't need me.
Thank you.
Well, go find another place. It may not be necessary, but we love doing it.
Amen.
We like praising Him and giving Him glory. Amen. We like it when His presence shows up. I can't imagine what this place is going to be like when His glory comes. Because there's some of these people that come crazy in His presence. They ain't got good mind when His presence comes. They lose all focus of themselves. They just act crazy. They'll close their eyes and go around in circles and fling their hands like that. And they'll go back like that. And they'll go up like that. And their eyes closed. And they'll go around and around and around. And there'll be people around trying to catch them. People around trying to shut them. And they'll go over here. They'll go over there. And they'll just be going here and there like that and all that. That's in His presence. Can you imagine what His glory is going to be like?
Amen. Praise the Lord.
Can you imagine what His glory is going to be like? Ha! I hope some of y'all here when it. When His glory does come, some of you little reserved people, some of y'all, you just ain't got the hang of this thing yet. When His glory comes, it's going to hit everybody in the house. It's going to get on in. It's going to get on everybody in the house that's looking for it. Because there's some of this stuff you're wanting, and you just don't know how to get it, and you're still kind of, you know. I remember. Here's the way. I can't remember when it first started. Then you get two hands up. Then you get them up to see a bit higher. Is my belt working? Just a little bit higher. You go just a little bit at a time. Am I right? Come on. Am I right? I'm right. A little bit at a time. And then finally, if you keep falling down the creek bank, you finally fall in. Oh, here you go now. Well, now nobody can shut you up, can't set you down. All they need to do is somebody pray, and here we go. All they got to do is hear the name of Jesus, and they're ready to run. They're ready to get up, throw both hands up, keep both feet out, shout by praises of God to the highest mountaintop. Here we go, here we go, here we go. But can you imagine when the glory shows up? Can you imagine the latter glory being greater than the former glory? Can you imagine us being greater than the Acts church? Can you imagine the mountain of God begin to quake and shake and the thunder and the lightning, and Moses was in, and the children of Israel were in, and yet the latter's will be greater than the former glory. Hallelujah. It's coming, brother Life. It's coming, preacher. It's coming, Lord. It's coming. Hallelujah. Glory to God. I gotta quit. I'm not done, but I gotta quit. I have no idea what I even done about. I think I've just all messed up when I come. Are you still with me? Have I done lost some of you? Huh? Amen. Well, yeah, I mean, you can see a lot of this today that people use. They use the church a lot of times. They like the manifestation, and they like the benefits they can get from that. And listen, we're no different today. There's people they'll drive thousands of miles. And they will give big offerings, just hoping, now just no guarantee, just hoping to receive some kind of manifestation from God in their life. They'll drive to another state just for one service. Because they heard about this hot one down the road. This church is hot right now. This preacher's hot right now. I'm going to go down here. It's going to take me 2 days to drive. I'm going to have this faith healer. I believe I can get healed in that faith meeting. Next thing you know, they'll get up there and they'll get every dime out of your pocket. You have money to get your gas and get back home. I don't know how they do that, but they'll get every dime out of your pocket. But the thing people don't realize is the same God that you drove 2 days to meet is the same God right here in this house. If you don't have about 5 minutes to meet. Hallelujah. And the same faith people over there, 2 days away, is the same faith people you worship with every Sunday and every Wednesday. The same God that will heal in that crusade is the same God that will heal in this house and any other house that worships the living God and knows the name. name of Jesus has been given the name above every name. The same Jesus can heal here just like he can there. I'm all messed up tonight. I was where I come, but I'm still messed up because I'm waiting and longing and hungering for the glory, preacher man. Hallelujah. I want the glory to come. I want the ladder to come. I want the latter rain and the former rain coming together and see the glory of God begin to move in the people of God and the fear of God restored back into the house of God and in the lives of the people of God, and we begin to walk in the fear of the Lord and experience this latter glory and this latter rain coming together with the former rain. Hallelujah. Glory to God. My God. Amos saw it. He saw the harvest so great, the plowman come back to plow the field before the harvest ever came in. Glory to God. Oh yeah, that's going to be real when the latter form of rain comes together. Glory to God. It's going to happen. It's going to happen. But we can't crawl back like the children of Israel did. We've got to be like Moses, man. We've got to go on the mountain.
Yeah, that's right. Amen.
Moses saw the burning bush. What did God tell him to do? Come here, Heather. I can't do mine. Mine's tight. Come here. What did he tell him to do?
Take your shoes off.
Take your shoes off. Oh, you got take your shoes off, Moses.
Oh, yeah.
Hell, you got a hole in your sock on. That's all right. Man, we don't care. We'll take the glove off. We'll take the glove off and do it for you. I'm embarrassed my worship leader here. Glory to God. Hold off. Why didn't you just take off one shoe? That's a good place for a pickup, right? Stick up. Listen. What did he tell Moses to do? Get back up here, Moses. What are you doing following me, Moses? You put me on the mountain. Say, so Moses, take your shoes off.
Yeah.
Well, you're coming on holy ground.
Yes.
Amen. See, when God, I'm getting ready, God, I'm getting ready to have a cow and calf. Now, see, before we get on the mountain with God, got him. Hope they got the home socks. Got him. We've got to take some things
off.
Gotta take jealousy off. Gotta take envy off. Gotta take bitterness off. Gotta take, oh God, gotta take unforgiveness off. Gotta take pleasantness off. Gotta take all some things off. Oh, gotta take pride off. Oh, glory to God. Hallelujah. Before we get on the glory, we gotta take some things off. But God said, my glory's coming. The power of God's coming. Hallelujah. And he said, take them all. Take them all. And come on the mountain of God. For the power of God, the power of God needs to fall upon the house of God and the people of God and burn some of this stuff out of our lives. But what we can begin to reveal, he can reveal his glory. We can walk in the glory of God. Moses, before you come up, don't you come to this burning bush, Moses, with them shoes on. Take your shoes off, Moses. We've got to take some things off, church. Got to get rid of some things. The glory is getting ready to be revealed. We're in the second day, well into the second day. Third day is going to raise us up. And we've got to have them shoes off on the third day, man. We've got to be revived. We got to be revived. That's a high five for me and you. Now, I got to tie my shoes and put my shoes back on again. Amen. Am I making any sense? Moses, you can put your shoes on. Come out of the fire and burn a book. Carol Ann, honey. They took my shoes off. Bunch of dirty dogs, I'm telling you, I've never in my life seen a bunch of people like that just take your shoes off. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Anybody want to come up here and tie my shoes for you? Amen. Anybody know what I'm talking about?
Amen.
Huh? Anybody agree with me that we need to get some things took off of us?
Yes.
Huh? Come on, church. Come on.
Amen.
Anybody agree with me that we need to take some things off?
Yes.
Huh? Get ready for the revealed glory of God?
Yes.
Huh?
Yes.
Come on, church. Don't give up on the preacher now. Come on, then. Come on. Now, I know this ain't for everybody. I wouldn't dare preach this on Sunday morning. Are you kidding me? Oh, you got to be kidding me, Jack. You think I preach something like this Sunday morning people all day? You kidding me? They never come back. No, sir, this is for the church. This is for the backbone of the church. This is for the Wednesday night people, boy. Boys, this is for the people of God that's ready, hungry, glory to God. Wanting to hear a word of God that'll get them ready for the glory. Oh, God, strip me, Holy Ghost. Strip me. Lay me bare before the face of God. Strip me of everything in me that's not of you. Clean me up. Oh, God, clean my thoughts up. Clean my mind up. Clean my actions up. Clean my attitude up. Do in me what only you can do, but I want to be ready for the glory. For the glory of God, I want to be ready for the glory. This ain't for everybody. Why scare them Sunday morning people come to death? They think I was crazy. How dare him preach like that to me? I see, you people don't get offended at me. Do you? No, we didn't take no love. No handle, no work. Amen. Am I making any sense?
Amen.
I haven't. You're telling them all right there. I ain't making no sense all night long. Glory to God. I ain't got nothing done here tonight. Amen. Are you still with me?
Amen.
I said, are you still with me?
Amen.
I said all that to say this. Now, I know you don't think I had a point in that, but you listen to me. Listen to me. We can live in the miraculous with sin undetected. Wow. We can live with sin undetected here in His presence, here in our meetings, even the place of miracles being done. Mm-hmm. We can live with sin undetected. Yeah. But sin cannot hide in the light of His glory.
Amen.
Can't do it. That's why we got to take some things off, man. That's why we got to get ready for the glory. Amen. Now, you know, well, God, not everybody that comes in this building on Sunday night, Sunday morning, is ready to go. Not everybody's really living for the Lord with all the heart. Now, you ain't that naive enough to believe that, are you? Huh? Does everybody agree with me that sin can go undetected here in His presence?
Yes.
You agree with that?
Yes.
Hey, you can hide that here. I don't care how powerful the presence is here. You can hide sin. Yeah. It can go undetected. Yeah. But not in His glory.
No.
Everywhere you read that Bible where the glory is manifested, when it came, immediate judgment came. When the glory was met with any kind of lack of fear or disrespect or irreverence, it was met very quickly with judgment. That's why everybody's not going to go. Because everybody don't want to go. Because when the glory comes, you're laid bare. You're laid open before God. Name of Jesus. Hallelujah. I love this old time holiness preaching. I do. This is where I get the most thrill of preaching. When I can preach holiness. I do. And I preach myself under conviction every time I preach it. Because I see how I am so far away from what He wants me to do. Wow. I don't know about y'all, but I struggle with thoughts a lot of times. I struggle with attitude a lot of time.
Amen.
I don't cuss no more. Praise God. Got that whipped. Got that whipped. High five, man. Come on. Yeah. There you go. Amen. Well, we all have issues, do we not?
Amen.
So we all need to begin to take some things off. If we don't get nothing else here tonight, let's get a hold of that.
Yeah, that's right.
Let's get ready for the glory.
Yes,
let's do what God told the children of Israel to do. Sanctify yourselves today and tomorrow for the third day. Good God.
Yes.
God, I feel that. I got Holy Ghost moving on me right now. Lord, it's going to take all me right now. Glory to God. Because it's real.
Yes.
It's real. It's real. Woo! Glory to God. I can't shut up. I won't do it. I can't shut up. It's real.
Yes,
we've got to get ourselves sanctified. Learn how to walk in the fields of the Lord.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Now, glory to God. Man. This will keep you up at night time, won't it? It will, boys. I go home sometimes, I can't close my eye. I'm sitting there with one eye closed, one eye open. I'm here, Carly, and I'm trying to interpret, and she's over there praying in tongues, sleeping in tongues. Here it goes. Oh, God. That's a trump of God telling on the mountain of God. That's like a trumpet sound, Carly, and she's on. Hallelujah. And the mountain's quaking, boys. And I love it. She told me yesterday, because yesterday she said I was her best friend. Ain't that good? That made me feel good. Then I looked and said, what's what you want? Because we know women, don't we? There's nothing coming in today. Ah, you know your woman, don't you? Yeah, glory to God. Yeah, you got to go home with her too. Amen. I got to quit. Amen. Church, let's get ready for the glory. What are you doing? Let's get ready for the glory. Amen. High five somebody beside you and tell them, get ready for the glory. I like that high five. Come on, Bobby. Don't high five somebody. Come on, man. I said high five somebody. Don't say them to me like you're high five somebody. Amen. Low five, whatever you want to do to them. Just give them five and say hallelujah. Get ready for the glory. Amen. I'm done. Damn it. I'm not done, but I got to quit. I butchered this enough to not bad, man. I mean, man, you just don't know how I butchered this enough. You just have to see my note, believe me. I butchered this enough tonight, but I feel good in butchering it up, though. I feel good. Hallelujah. I may have butchered up, but you don't know that. So it don't matter. You don't know nothing. Amen. Who said that?
Yeah.
It was on the door, but somebody took it down. So I forget who's going to be there. I don't forgot. I don't forgot the name of the group will be there. At Wyoming East, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Friday, Saturday.
Saturday.
What?
Saturday.
Do you know the name of the groups will be there?
I think it's called Surrender in the Hearts.
Huh?
I think it's called Surrender in the Hearts.
Surrender in the Hearts? God, that preacher is not with us. Wow, you're good, bro. Hey, man, that's good. Okay. Somebody else, who told me? You told me about something.
Movie in the Park at Oceana Friday.
What is it?
Movie in the Park.
Movie in the Park? Is that the name of the movie? Wait a minute. Oh, a movie in the park. Oh. Always have a movie named Movie in the Park. It's a scary movie. It's about Friday the 13th. No, it's not. It's a movie in the park, honey. Is food going to be involved?
I believe so.
Hot dog, hot diggity dog. Going to be free?
No, I'm not sure.
You love it. I'd have said lie, then I'd said yeah, then repented for lying. Don't know. I'd said yeah, then I said. Amen. Okay. Movie in the park. Is that what you say Friday night? Okay. Okay. All right. All hearts and minds clear? Yeah. Anybody need prayer tonight?